10 years ago today, the face of our nation changed forever. In honor of those who lost their lives, a national memorial was held where the Twin Towers once stood. And several events also going on around our area to remember the tragedy as well. Hear from local families who lost loved ones on that day as 6 News starts right now.
Live from the news station, WATE-TV Knoxville, this is 6 News at 6.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Jill McNeil. 10 years ago today, the mindset, the history, and the future of America were changed in ways no one could imagine. You probably remember exactly where you were and what you were doing when you heard about the attacks on the World Trade Centers, then the Pentagon, then that fourth plane crashing in Pennsylvania. In all three places, today was a day for mourning, for memory, and regrowth. ABC's TJ Winnick reports from Ground Zero in New York City.
Americans pause today to remember. At Ground Zero in New York, 6 separate moments of silence in memory of all those lost on September 11th, 10 years ago today.
I wish my dad had been there to teach me how to drive, ask a girl out on a date, and see me graduate from high school.
The children, spouses, and friends of those killed got their first look at the 9/11 memorial. The names of the fallen preserved in bronze and, of course, read aloud.
Juan Marrero.
Some made a keepsake to take home. Others simply prayed.
Good works and public service have taken root to honor those we loved and lost.
They were joined beside the enormous pools in the footprints of where the towers once stood by former President George W. Bush and President Obama, who recited Psalm 46.
God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble.
There were events at the two other crash sites, at the Pentagon and in Shanksville, Pennsylvania, where Flight 93 crashed after its passengers heroically struggled with the hijackers.
This is the place where Americans said no. They weren't going to stand for what was happening.
Over 1,200 special requests were honored to have the name of a 9/11 victim placed next to the name of a friend, loved one, or coworker on that memorial. TJ Winnick, ABC News, New York.
Well, there was a scare in the skies today as fighter jets were scrambled and had to escort a plane to JFK Airport in New York. Officials say the pilot became spooked when some passengers made frequent trips to the bathroom. The plane did land safely. The passengers are now being held until that situation can be resolved. Well, the 10th anniversary of the September 11th attacks is remembered here in Knoxville as well. 3 former Knoxville residents killed on 9/11 were honored this morning at the City County Building. 6 News reporter Jamie Lynn Drohan spoke with the victims' family members after the moving service.
Bagpipers and a horse-drawn fire engine led a procession from Market Square to the City County Building this morning. Today's 10th anniversary of the September 11th attacks have forced many to face a memory that seems too painful to heal. For people here in Knoxville, like Brenda Vandiver, it's not the first time they've done this walk, as she clutches a picture of her brother Tony inside a bouquet of flowers.
Well, it only seems like yesterday, so 10th anniversary, 5th anniversary, really doesn't matter to me. I mean, he's gone. And there's a hole in my heart. I'm sad.
The wounds are still so fresh. Among the crowds of family and friends included members of the Knoxville Fire Department, police, and city officials. An American flag billowed through the air downtown as it hung draped from the ladder of a fire engine. Bruce Haviland was here today to remember his brother, Tim.
Every year, 9/11 is a day where I'm numb. And I always call my parents, call my other brothers and sisters and talk to them. There are 7 of us living. And it's a day, I'm numb.
The 10 years has gone by very quickly. And as I recall, the day was very much like this one. Beautiful, sunshiny day. Who would have ever thought that such a barbaric thing could occur, a barbaric, unprovoked attack on innocent people.
God bless America.
The Lenores, Havilands, and Williams family all say they feel grateful to have a place here in Knoxville like the September 11th Memorial, a place where their loved ones can be remembered forever with so many others who lost their lives during the 9/11 attacks. In Knoxville, Jamie Lindrohan, 6 News.
Many of the families tell 6 News they plan to visit the 9/11 Memorial in New York City in the future, but not on the anniversary. They'd rather go on a day where they can walk around and really take it all in without the crowds and the distractions. Well, UT students today holding a fundraiser to help families affected by 9/11. Public relations students held the event at the Barnes & Noble on Kingston Pike. Today's events included readings by special guests, games, face painting, and appearances by the mascot Smokey and Chili. UT Air Force and ROTC cadets took part in a ceremony to honor those who lost their lives. They say it is important to remember what today symbolizes.
It's really important to us as college students. Our generation, we were all between 8 and 12 when this happened, really kind of a defining moment. And as we've grown older, I think it's really cool to be able to do something like this and give back.
All the proceeds from today's event benefit Tuesday's Children, a charity that helps people impacted by 9/11 and others who've been affected by global terrorism. Well, members of the Blue and Red Knights held their annual September 11th Memorial Ride in Knoxville today with nearly 1,000 bikes and riders at World's Fair Park. Chairman Randy Gray says the local fire and police communities are committed to honoring the memory of those who were lost 10 years ago.
There's no way we should forget the firefighters, the police officers, the Port Authority people, and the regular citizens that died that day. There's no way we should forget them, and this is how we pay our tribute to them every year.
Partial proceeds from the ride will go to the Blair Volunteer Fire Department. Well, Mass was celebrated this morning at Knoxville's Holy Ghost Catholic Church in honor of first responders. The Blue Mass was held by Bishop Richard Sticca. It's held to celebrate the spiritual intentions of police, firefighters, and uniformed emergency responders. The church says it's a way to honor and recognize the sacrifice of those who work to keep us safe. In Blount County, the rescue squad there held a ceremony at the 9/11 Memorial in Grandview Cemetery.
Michael Bacino.
They rang a fire bell as they read the name of each emergency responder who died that day. Deputy Chief Ed Wolf personally lost 2 New York City firefighter friends. He spent the next 3 weeks working at the World Trade Center site as a FEMA search and rescue manager.
It seems like it was just yesterday that this occurred, and we need to make sure that we, as a community, as a nation, as emergency services responders, don't forget those that we lost on that day.
Wolf wants every first responder to keep working together, no matter the color of their uniform, in honor of the victims. In the city of Loudoun, hundreds remembered 9/11 by coming out for a bridge painting and dedication. TDOT supplied all the materials needed today to complete the project, including paint, buckets, brushes, and rollers. But it was pride and community spirit that brought churches, civic groups, and veterans organizations together to paint the John J. Duncan Jr. Memorial Bridge that spans the Tennessee River.
The bridge itself was dirty, and it needed to be painted and cleaned up. And we got the idea, since it was a veterans memorial bridge, that we would involve veterans in painting it. And then 9/11, of course, was in the forefront, so we decided to do it on this day, and that included law enforcement, firefighters, and other people of that nature.
And this is a great country because of doing the things like you're doing here today. So many people working to paint this bridge and do community service here today.
The bridge opened about 11 years ago, replacing a dangerous narrow steel bridge. Now with a new coat of paint, it looks new again, and everyone in Loudoun is proud of what they accomplished. Well, many people are sharing their thoughts tonight on our 6 News Facebook page about where they were on 9/11 and how they're feeling on the 10th anniversary of the attacks. Martha Godsey saying, "I remember sitting at my home on my day off, drinking coffee in bed, flipping channels, and they broke into a news alert. A plane had accidentally hit the World Trade Center. Right after that, the second plane hit. Then we realized it wasn't an accident." Laura Pearmain Potts commented, I was at work when I heard the news and I thought, how sad. It really didn't hit me until I got home and saw it all on TV. Then it was very upsetting and very sad when I was able to see it. Shocking, very shocking was my thinking then. Jennifer Hefner DeSaltas remembers that day saying, I was at home, my husband, then fiance, called and told me to turn on the TV and not to leave the house unless I absolutely had to because no one knew what was going to happen. I sat there watching in total disbelief and shock as the second plane flew into the tower. I couldn't do anything but cry. Definitely the most memorable tragedy in my lifetime. Thank you to our viewers for sharing those thoughts with us. Remember, you can always post your comments online. Just go to Facebook and search for WATE 6 News page. You can also send us your pictures at pics@wate.com. Welcome back. The National 9/11 flag tour has ended in Joplin, Missouri. The flag originally flew on a building across the street from Ground Zero. Both were damaged in the attacks. Pieces of American flags that survived May's deadly Joplin tornado are now being used to stitch up the 9/11 flag. When the flag leaves Joplin, it will become part of the September 11th National Museum in New York City. A flight headed for Baltimore had to be diverted to Nashville because of a passenger's suspicious behavior. Officials say the Southwest flight from Albuquerque was cut short yesterday afternoon after a flight attendant noticed a passenger going to and from the bathroom several times. The behavior prompted the flight crew to divert the flight to Nashville out of caution. The passenger was questioned but not charged. The FBI says a plastic item was found in the bathroom, but it was not.
This is a special edition of World News, America Remembers. 10 years later, two presidents side by side, a nation resilient, remembering, reuniting. 10 years after that moment, we all knew this was not an accident.
Oh my God.
We just saw another plane.
To watch powerless is a horror.
A decade later, Ground Zero reimagined. Tonight, the extraordinary moments. Families invited in for the first time, finding the names of their loved ones. The children tracing the names with their fingertips. So many now grown up.
I wish my dad had been there to teach me how to drive, ask a girl out on a date.
And tonight, the survivors from the Twin Towers and the Pentagon. 10 years later, what we never knew, what they really saw through those windows, the flash of blue that kept a group of firefighters going. And as a nation looks forward tonight, so do we, taking you straight to the top of One World Trade Center, what will now be the largest skyscraper in the Western Hemisphere. From New York to Washington to Shanksville, World News starts now.
From ABC News, this is a special edition of World News with David Muir. 9/11. America remembers.
And good evening on this September 11th. 10 years later, we are a nation looking forward after a day, after a decade of looking back. On this anniversary, we all watched as a corner was turned, Ground Zero reimagined, now open, as families were invited in for the first time to see the names of their loved ones etched into the side of those giant reflecting pools that have now replaced the craters left by the Twin Towers. The children right there with their small camera. The boy determined to take home the name of his loved one. The names, by the way, etched in bronze, family members will be able to read and touch year-round. The bronze is temperature-controlled, cooled to the touch in the summer, and warm to the touch in the winter. There were so many powerful images today, and they began unfolding this morning at the same time that morning changed our country 10 years ago. They entered Ground Zero together, President Obama and President Bush and the First Ladies, a sign of solidarity, much like what this nation saw in the hours and days after 9/11, when all of the world watched that cruel plot unfold.
Good morning, America. How nice to see all of you. I'm Charles Gibson.
I'm Diane Sawyer. It's Tuesday, September 11th, 2001.
8:46 that morning.
We just got a report in that there's been some sort of explosion at the World Trade Center in New York City.
9:03.
Does not appear that there's any kind of an effort up there yet. Now remember, oh my God.
Oh my God.
That looks like a second plane.
That just exploded.
We just saw another plane coming in from the side. Oh, this is terrifying. Awful.
To watch powerless is a horror.
9:37, and this time, Washington.
We now have fire confirmed at the Pentagon.
22 minutes later.
You can see the firemen assembled here, the police officers, FBI agents, and you can see the two towers. A huge explosion now, raining debris on all of us. We better get out of the way.
There's second building that was hit by the plane has just completely collapsed.
The building has collapsed?
The building has collapsed.
We're talking about massive casualties here at the moment.
10:03 and Flight 93 crashing in Shanksville, Pennsylvania.
That a large plane has now crashed.
10:28, 102 minutes after that first plane hit, the second of the two towers falls.
Oh my God. Both trade towers, where thousands of people work on this day, Tuesday, have now been attacked and destroyed. And so if you're a parent, you got a kid in some other part of the country, call them up.
But 10 years later, the nation resilient and reuniting. This morning at what New York's mayor hopes will no longer be called Ground Zero, instead a memorial, 10 years in the making. The sunrise, the blue skies, so much like that morning, but today a determination to mark a new beginning. The waterfalls that now fill the craters left by those towers, the largest man-made waterfalls in the world. This morning, moments of silence. At each one of those key times, those moments we'll never forget. And the names read by family members, the victims from 93 different countries, and the president 10 years later speaking behind bulletproof glass.
God is our refuge and strength.
There was the boy who lost his dad in the World Trade Center, one of the many trying to help others escape. That boy, now a young man.
I wish my dad had been there to teach me how to drive, ask a girl out on a date, and see me graduate from high school. I hope that I can make my father proud of the young men that my brother and I have become. I miss you so much, Dad.
And then the extraordinary moment, the families allowed in for the first time, seeing the pools and seeing their loved ones' names etched in bronze, putting their hands to the names, the children using their fingertips to trace the names of loved ones, and the hugs, so many of them. And there was Betty Ann Ong's family and the two roses. She was the flight attendant on Flight 11 calling into operations to say, I think we're getting hijacked. The endless etching today, children determined to take those names home with them. And there was the girl who simply put her head down. At the Pentagon today, another service. Remembering the 184 killed on board that flight and inside the Pentagon. And to that valiant team on board Flight 93, who could forget? Let's roll. And the cell phone calls from inside that plane.
Please tell my children that I love them very much. And I'm so sorry they, I don't know what to say. There's three guys, they've hijacked the plane. I'm trying to be calm. We're turned around and I've heard that there's planes that have been flown into the World Trade Center. I hope to be able to see your face again, baby. I love you. Bye.
Today, we heard the young voices bringing comfort to that unforgotten field. While back in New York, Paul Simon, who said after 9/11 he wasn't sure he could ever make an album again, came back 10 years later.
And the vision that was planted in my brain still remains within the sound.
So many people embracing at a transformed Ground Zero today, and as soon as tomorrow, the memorial at Ground Zero will be open to the public. Free tickets will be issued, but they're only going to allow about 1,500 people in at a time to protect the sanctity of the memorial. As you all know, we went into this weekend with security very tight here in New York and Washington and really across the country. After word of that possible Al-Qaeda threat, the warnings of a possible car bomb attack. ABC's Brian Ross, of course, tracking this going into this weekend. He's with us here tonight with the latest. Brian, where does it stand?
Well, David, still no hard evidence of any kind that the plot was real. The FBI has now interviewed some 300 people based on flight logs. They've all been cleared. They were not connected in any way to terrorism, according to the FBI. Still, they continue to look.
This does not stop after tonight, this investigation.
That's right.
You also told us of the jitters today on 9/11, reports that fighter jets had, in fact, been scrambled.
That's right. An American Airlines flight from Los Angeles to New York was accompanied to the ground by two F-16 fighter jets after air marshals on board the plane reported strange behavior by three men who were coming and going from the bathroom. It turns out that's all they were doing, and they were questioned and released. and everybody else on the plane was let go.
But reassuring that the fighter jets were there.
They were there.
Brian Ross tonight, thanks very much. Protecting this nation has been the mission for so many young people, shaped by what they witnessed as a child on 9/11. And for 10 years, we have, of course, been a nation at war. For 10 years, ABC's Martha Raddatz has been following those children who grew up and went to war for their country.
Just hours after the Pentagon was hit, with the building still smoldering, the horror still fresh, many of the 20,000 Pentagon employees came back to work to prepare for war. 10 years later, well over 2 million Americans, all of them volunteers, have been deployed to Iraq and Afghanistan. Among them, a generation of young soldiers we have met who were just children on 9/11.
You're a little boy.
Yeah, I was a fifth grader.
Were you frightened?
I was a little frightened at first, but I was reassured by my parents that we'd be all right.
You saw it on TV. I can't imagine you ever thought, gee, I'll probably be over there fighting someday.
I don't know. Ever since then, I kind of wanted to.
In this decade of war, the nation has lost more than 6,000 troops and had more than 45,000 injured. Military spending during that period reached an astonishing $6 trillion. But today, there is much that the military is proud of. The biggest achievement, the death of bin Laden and the decimation of Al-Qaeda leadership.
Al-Qaeda is on the ropes, and it continues to get pummeled.
We are, of course, still a nation at war. There are 144,000 Americans still serving in war zones. But by the end of next year, that should be cut in half. David?
All right, Martha Raddatz with us tonight. Martha, thanks so much. I want to bring in ABC's Christiane Amanpour, the host of This Week. And Christiane, so moved this morning by the headlines you recalled around the world on 9/11.
You know, the one ray of sunshine out of 9/11 was that instant global solidarity, that famous French headline from Le Monde saying, "We are all Americans today." That feeling was ripped asunder by the divisions over Iraq. But now, 10 years later, in the Arab part of the world, this Arab uprising, this Arab Spring, which is a direct repudiation of Osama bin Laden, everything he stood for, and a direct desire for democracy and freedom and a progressive relationship with the rest of the world.
And you and I saw it in Tahrir Square in Egypt, the dominoes falling, and in many cases, the people telling us they want a new relationship with America.
That's right, a relationship based on mutual respect and dignity, mutual benefit, and one that now, really, American foreign policy will have to take into account the Arab street, and maybe now it'll be more friendly because it will not be under the yoke of dictators who they believe the U.S. supported and kept in place.
Christiane Amanpour with us tonight. Christiane, thanks so much. And still ahead here on this special edition of World News, the survivors. From the Twin Towers to the Pentagon tonight, some of what they saw we'd never heard about. The view across that one office floor and that flash of blue, why it changed the course for a group of firefighters. And then the snapshots of the lost, all of those flyers on 9/11, we haven't forgotten them. Tonight, the story those images still tell 10 years later. And later tonight, a nation looking forward. The view on this 9/11 you haven't seen. Tonight, we're going to take you straight to the top of the new World Trade Center, Americans taking back the sky. All this past week here on World News, we've been going back to find the survivors of 9/11, from the Twin Towers to the Pentagon. They've spent this last decade hugging their loved ones a little tighter, a way, they say, to honor those who lost that chance 10 years ago.
10 years ago this morning, Florence Jones was heading to work in New York. Sheila Moody was heading to the Pentagon. And Captain Jay Jonas was at the New York Fire Department.
What a beautiful day this started off to be, and it descended into hell on earth.
Florence was on the 78th floor of the South Tower of Manager when the North Tower was hit. And this is what she told us on the first anniversary.
To see these young people doing the sign of the cross and jumping, you were like, oh my God, it's got to be awful up there for people to make that choice.
Florence had left the 78th floor and had gone down to 77.
I could see straight across the floor, which was all glass, and I could not figure out on a bright, sunny, cloudless day what this black thing was that was approaching the building.
Moments later, the second plane hit the floor she had just been on. Of the last 25 people out of the South Tower, she was number 18. 10 years later, she had not been back to Ground Zero, until she went with us. For Sheila Moody, it was just her second day on the job at the Pentagon. One of her brand new co-workers came to her desk and asked, "Did you hear? Two planes have hit the World Trade Center."
10 seconds later, I heard a whistling, like a whistling sound and a rumble.
This time, it was the Pentagon, and Sheila was soon in a ball of fire. And then, a voice.
And he was saying, "Is there anybody in there?" And I said, "Yes, we're here. We're here."
And so she started to clap, hoping he could follow the sound. He extinguished the flames between them and pulled her out.
His hand was out to you.
His hand was out to me, yeah.
10 years later, she shows me her hands, the burn scars. A small price, she says, to have survived to see her first granddaughter. There was another blessing that emerged after the two towers fell. A tiny miracle on stairwell B in the North Tower. A flight of stairs somehow still standing. Captain Jay Jonas and his men inside that stairwell.
All of a sudden, a beam of sunshine broke through the dust, and it came into the stairway. And it almost looked like a light from the heavens, literally.
They followed it and survived. 10 years later and two promotions later, Deputy Chief Jonas now told us he still remembers the fathers who were lost that day. And we won't forget what we all heard from him just this week about why he never walked away.
I wanted to be a fireman since I was a little kid. And this is, you know, other than playing center field for the Yankees, this is the only job I ever wanted.
Still time for the Yankees.
Still time.
Still time, still hope. When we come back tonight, those flyers, those faces taped onto so many buildings and trucks in New York after 9/11, stories they still tell. We will never forget that in the days after 9/11, you couldn't go anywhere in New York without seeing the faces, the flyers, the handmade posters of loved ones still missing. Tonight, ABC's Katie Couric on the portraits of grief still moving a nation.
He calls them snapshots of lives interrupted as they were actively being lived. Former New York Times executive editor Hal Raines says in the weeks after September 11th, no single aspect of the newspaper's coverage generated more reader response than portraits of grief.
The purpose was that we didn't want to write premature obituaries of people whose fate we didn't know.
Inspired by the hundreds of missing persons flyers that wallpapered Lower Manhattan, Portraits of Grief was a series of brief biographies that appeared in the paper every day for 15 weeks.
It lingers in our memory because it is a life being lived.
A team of reporters interviewed over 1,900 families. And in roughly 200 words, the legacies of their loved ones, battalion chiefs, working moms, first-time fathers, were preserved.
That it developed a momentum that even people who might have turned away wound up thinking of this as a way to memorialize the nobility of ordinary life.
So this array of faces, sometimes imperfectly reproduced, eulogized those who were lost and told a heartbroken nation who they were, what they did, and who they loved. That Peter Galinas took his three-year-old on a camping trip. That her four nephews called Suzanne Garrity the Kiss Monster. That firefighter Michael Mullen loved to play the piano. In other words, that they were us.
And Katie Couric's here on the desk in New York. And Katie, all those images so powerful that day. You and I were talking about the woman being so emblematic of those powerful images from downtown.
That's right. In fact, one critic, David, said photojournalism got its job back that day. And there's so many extraordinary photographs from September 11th and the days that follow.
The father trying to get his son to safety.
That's right. He'd picked his little boy up, who was 2 and a half, from preschool at nearby Trinity Church. He was rushing to the Hudson River. He said to the police officer, water. And the officer thought he needed a drink of water, gave the little boy his mask. And the father in the photo has been searching for this police officer ever since. And then there's another photo of a woman who was able to get out of the South Tower burning and bleeding. A deputy U.S. Marshal came to her aid, and they've become fast friends.
The friendships forged that morning.
Right.
ABC's Katie Kirk, great to have you on board.
Thanks, David.
And Katie, we should point out that you and your team tracked down the faces behind those images. The extraordinary reunions tonight on a special edition of 2020 at 10 Eastern, 9 Central. Katie, thanks again. And when we come back here on the broadcast, we take you to the very top of the New World Trade Center. And finally tonight here, we look forward on this September 11th. ABC's Dan Harris with the view from atop the New World Trade Center.
In the days after 9/11, when Ground Zero was a pile of smoldering steel, I saw for myself the extraordinary pull this place exerted on Americans.
There's no words to describe it. It's just all those people, you know? It's real, real tragic.
For most of the intervening decade, Ground Zero has been just a hole in the ground. But as the world saw today, the September 11th memorial is finally finished. Inside the exact footprints of the towers, two of the largest man-made waterfalls on Earth. And right next door, the largest skyscraper in the Western Hemisphere is rising. It's called One World Trade Center.
We're very high up.
We're very high up.
It's incredible.
81 stories are up, and it will ultimately be 104 stories at a symbolic 1,776 feet.
What you realize quite powerfully when you visit One World Trade Center is that this is not just a building, not just a construction job. This is New Yorkers reoccupying, retaking the sky.
Unlike the Twin Towers, this building will have a core made out of concrete that is 7 times stronger than the concrete in a sidewalk. Architect David Childs.
Do you think it's safe enough that you would go to work there every
day? Absolutely. I would feel more safe in this building than most of the buildings in New York.
Right after 9/11, the mantra was never forget. But moving on, some say, is a form of tribute too. The people behind the new Ground Zero say they have struck the right balance between rebuilding and remembering.
W. Friedlander.
Dan Harris, ABC
Andrew
News, New York.
Love that, retaking the sky. Don't forget a special edition of 2020 later here this evening. Diane Sawyer, right back in the chair tomorrow night. Good night.
The tragedy of September 11th united our country. This year, as we open the 9/11 Memorial in New York City, we ask that you join us to honor, remember, and reunite. To learn more or to reserve your visit, go to 9.
Tonight, on a special edition of 2020, Remembrance and Renewal. 10 years after the 9/11 attacks. Diane Sawyer with the children of 9/11. Babies who never knew their fathers, now grown up.
I never met him, but I know I love him.
I look exactly like him.
Katie Couric on the iconic pictures that captured that day and the emotional reunions still taking place between the saved and their saviors.
Hey, how are you?
Elizabeth Vargas, with spouses who got a second chance at love.
Did you think you were going to spend the rest of your life alone?
Bob Woodruff, with the brave men who are building back Ground Zero.
Standing on this hollow ground, seeing the flag flying over here and the Statue of Liberty over there, I mean, it's about as patriotic as you can get.
And Chris Cuomo, with the relics that were left behind.
When people see the memorial, what do you want them to remember?
To be as strong as that steel.
Tonight, Remembrance and Renewal. Here now, Chris Cuomo and Elizabeth Vargas.
Today, New Yorkers and the entire nation spent the day remembering an event we will never forget. As memorial tributes and testimonials played out, we were reminded once again of the strength and heroism we witnessed in the days and even the decade after 9/11. From Ground Zero at the World Trade Center to the Pentagon to a field in Pennsylvania, families came together to honor their lost loved ones.
And we witnessed a different kind of family reunion here, and by all means, they are part of our family by now. The babies born after 9/11, with fathers they would never know. Over the course of the last 10 years, Diane Sawyer has been gathering with these incredible survivors for a sort of living scrapbook, one that mixes tears and laughter and so much love in the face of so much loss.
We're going to have 62 babies squalling at the top of their lungs.
Almost 10 years ago, it was a kind of Olympic event.
Is there any way on earth this can work?
Trying to corral the babies. Babies born to mothers pregnant on 9/11. Babies whose fathers never came home. But we did it, one monumental photograph.
Here we go, everybody in this camera, say cheese, cheese.
And all those babies are babies no more, now almost 10 years old.
I was right there.
What do you think when you look at that?
I should have had a binky.
Morgan Rodriguez then, and now all grown up.
This is so amazing.
Still wearing her dad's firefighter medallion.
That's great. You're going to keep that for life, I bet.
Diane, I'm Kevin. Kevin.
And the toddler who told us.
My dad, like my his name is Kevin, and I'm Kevin.
Well, Kevin now. Baby Jack Patrick tossed high in the air, now doing the tossing.
The champion.
This is a picture of my father. Well, I really love him. I miss him a lot. I never met him, but I know I love him.
People say you can't miss what you never had, but you know, he sees when he goes to school that other kids have dads.
One more funny face.
And so they try to create memories out of what they have. His backstage passes, his lacrosse stick, his biking jersey.
I sleep with one of his shirts.
Why?
Because it just makes me feel good and safe.
I have his basketball.
You have his basketball?
Come on, baby!
When we went for our level 2 ultrasound, I left to go to the bathroom. He asked the doctor what we were having, and he did tell me. I always tell Grace that. You know, Grace, Daddy knew you were Grace. He knew who you were.
And what every child in this room treasured the most was the living proof they are Daddy's child.
It could be something silly like Jack doesn't like mayonnaise. Well, neither did Daddy Jim.
Why do I laugh like this? And I'll say, well, let me tell you why.
My mom says that I have his eyes. They say I look like him.
I feel like his humor was a big part of me.
She said that he was free-spirited, and she said that I was too.
It's a visible reminder, both for these kids, but also to the world, that I belonged to this person. I'm from them, and I carry some of them with me.
Sometimes I ask, does he look like me? She says yes. I look exactly like him. This makes me feel closer to him for some reason. I don't know why.
My mom always tells me that he was very energetic and stuff. Like, he had a lot of energy.
He also played the drums, and she loves the drums.
Come to Daddy, buddy.
Robert Atwood's dad, Gerald, was a firefighter.
What's the thing that stays in your mind?
His look.
How you mean?
It's him. He has his hat on, ladder 21. It's all his gear. Like when I go to when I'm trying to go to sleep, I look at the picture, and then I look in the mirror. It looks kind of like me, and it's looking in the eyes. Sometimes I have these dreams, like when Duke would bring a person back to life, and him, and then I would wake up.
Even all those years ago, the mothers hoped that their children would have some way of knowing they weren't the only ones.
It'd be great if he had some long-lasting friends. It's important. No, you're not alone. Then he'll never be alone.
It's Sean, me, Phelan, and this is Robin.
And you're the BFF, what, da-da-da?
BFF, W-A-D.
The best friends forever.
Without a dad.
Without a dad.
I don't think I'd get along without these girls who help me. Help me get through it.
You can always call each other.
Yeah, we all hate pickles.
Although she talks about
you hate pickles. If that's not a bonding thing, I don't know what is.
It's cool that we're here again. I don't feel like I'm the only one who's had that before to them. Like, these guys know how it feels.
At an age when even the smallest things can make you a target for teasing, no one wants to be known as that 9/11 kid.
How do you talk about it at school? Do kids ever ask you?
Yeah.
What do you say?
Well, I try and avoid them. You know, the kids who do ask, I try and avoid. Because I know that they'll keep asking me and asking me month through month. And so I just avoid them.
And there's also a message from the mothers in this room. They, too, are ready to move forward.
So what's the first word that comes to mind when I say, how are you?
Doing well.
Peaceful.
I'm happy.
Happy.
It's good to see you.
Look at you, too. Oh.
Jenna Jacobs-Dick. She decided to wear the dress she had worn at her bridal shower, the wedding pearls given her by her husband, Ari.
It does get better, and I mean something specific by that. Nothing can make his death better. Nothing can bring him back. Nothing can take the pain away. That exists. But my ability to cope with that pain, that gets better. I also had the kindness of strangers and packages that showed up on my door and reminded me that I wasn't living in a world filled with terrorists. I was living in a world filled with amazing people who want to help.
Is this our first walker?
And we have a message, too, from someone we've often been asked about over the years, Bahraheen Ashrafi, the Muslim woman. Her husband was a physicist in Bangladesh, but worked as a waiter at Windows on the World just to bring his family to America. After the attack, she told us how people had harassed her for being a Muslim, not knowing she was a 9/11 widow. Her husband had always done the driving, so Bahraheen had to take a courageous step.
You did fine. This is going to be your temporary license.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. It's valid for 3 months, so it's not necessary to go into motor vehicles. Okay? All right? I'm going to need your signature.
A decade later, here she is, suburban mom, and a regular in the carpool.
Okay.
And her Farkat?
I want to see you walk.
Yes.
Now heading into the fourth grade.
Daddy's watching you all the time, Farkat. Even though you can see him, he's seeing you. And he's so proud of you, and you'll make him proud.
And it was Bahraheen, nearly 10 years ago, in this room, who told her child, when you want to talk to your dad, close your eyes and look inside your heart.
I love that. I thought it was absolutely beautiful.
Mona! Mona!
Where does your dad live?
Heaven.
Heaven. And who does he live with?
God.
And who else?
Angels.
Angels. And when you want to talk to Daddy Jim, what do? You close your eyes and look inside the mirror. And where's your heart? Oh, yes, that's nice, love. Daddy loves you. Kids
laughing in the look back. Into your heart and into the mirror, where all the life he gave you is still your life to come.
A little voice came on the phone and said, Daddy, when you come home, he said the first thing that came to his mind, I'm already there. Take a look around. I'm the sunshine in your hair. I'm the shadow on the ground. I'm the whisper in the wind. I'm your imaginary friend. And I know
When we come back, Katie Couric with the pictures you remember and a reunion you'll never forget.
For my 343 brothers who didn't make it.
And for my brother.
This shows the world that we can rebuild.
And that we are strong.
It's for the heroes like my dad.
This year, the National September 11th Memorial opens in New York City. Join us to honor, remember, and reunite. To learn more or to reserve your visit, go to 911memorial.org.
This special edition of 2020 continues with Katie Couric.
This event was so pyrotechnic and catastrophic. It was so unconscionable and horrific that people had to somehow record it in order to hold it and just sort of process it.
These images are not etched into our memory, they are seared. From the day's unvarnished horror to its undaunted courage, the events of September 11th unfolded in shocking photographs as the terrified eyes of a nation looked on in disbelief.
Ingrid Sishi, the critic, said photojournalism got its job back that day.
Then I noticed there was a guy on the outside of one of the towers, and he was holding on to the outside of the building. All of a sudden, I saw people start coming out from the building.
Jumping.
Well, I don't know if they jumped or fell. We don't know.
In 41 years with the Associated Press, photographer Richard Drew has never turned his lens away from tragedy. Not even when bodies began tumbling from the Twin Towers. The harrowing photo of a man frozen in the final seconds of his life was immediately controversial when it appeared in hundreds of newspapers across the country, as well as on page A7 of the New York Times. Hal Raines was the Times executive editor.
We had a serious discussion about whether to publish this picture because of the concern for the family, but it seemed to me to so perfectly capture the tragedy of the day that I felt we should share it with our readers.
Although some believe he was a restaurant worker at Windows on the World, the falling man, as he came to be known, was never officially identified.
You can't help but wonder what was going through this man's mind and the minds of so many people who perished this way that day.
That man, in a sense, was all of New York that day. It's this intrusion of the cataclysmic that takes a mundane moment and changes your life forever.
Scores of ordinary lives were forever changed that day, and some still have the scars to show for it.
When the first plane hit One World Trade, our building swayed.
Donna Spira was working on the 100th floor of the South Tower.
This one guy that I worked with, he's like, come on, we're getting the F out of here, and started walking down.
They made it to the 78th floor sky lobby, where along with about 200 others, they waited for an express elevator to take them to the ground, having no idea they were directly in the line of fire that was United Flight 175.
It was an eerie quiet after the plane hit. Just very quiet.
What about all those people?
they all died. 12 of us made it.
Do you wonder why me? Why was I spared?
Mm-hmm. Till this day, I do.
Crawling on her hands and knees, Donna made it to the one passable staircase and began the seemingly endless descent, 78 floors to the lobby.
Coming out of the building, I just fell to my knees, and he was there.
He was Dominic Guadagnoli, a deputy U.S. Marshal who had rushed to the scene from a nearby courthouse. As he scooped up a burned and bleeding Donna in his arms, dozens of photographers captured their every move.
That was very unsettling for both of you, wasn't it?
It irked me more for her. You want to tell them, put the camera down and the help out. Forget about the camera.
He carried her across the street to a makeshift triage center set up on the sidewalk.
I'm gonna put her down on the ground, but she said, don't let me go. She squeezed me really tight. She said, don't let me go.
They were together only minutes before an ambulance whisked Donna away. But as days passed and theirs became a photo seen around the world, Dominic could not stop wondering about what had happened to her.
Outside of wanting to see my kids and see my family, it was the forefront of my mind because I didn't know how she was.
So the U.S. Marshal went on a manhunt.
He doesn't know her name, but somehow feels duty-bound to find her.
And in late September, one of Donna's neighbors saw Dominic's appeal on Inside Edition. They were reunited, this time not for the cameras, but for each other, in the privacy of Donna's New Jersey home.
We hugged and talked, and it was like we'd known each other for years.
It's not a big deal.
And their friendship endures. They still socialize and keep in touch through emails, understanding each other in ways even their own spouses cannot.
Just a bond, and nobody can ever imagine what we went through unless you were there.
In a way, are you grateful that the photographer captured that moment? Because from that photograph came this friendship.
Just for that reason. It showed hope, people helping people, that we're all together in this.
There were countless selfless acts captured on film that day, some heroic, some simple. Boaz Schnitzer had just dropped off his 2-year-old son, Itamar, at Trinity Preschool, located only a block from the Trade Center, when the second plane struck. He ran back to the school, and within minutes, the South Tower fell, and the school began filling with dust and debris.
At some point when it was impossible, you know, to breathe, they just shouted, okay, we must evacuate.
Boaz put little Itamar on his shoulders and started running for the Hudson River.
You know, the first person I saw was a cop. And I ran toward him and I asked him, you know, where's the water? And probably he thought that, you know, I'm asking for water. So the first thing he did, he took off his, you know, the mask from him and put on Itamar. And secondly, let me drink water. And I kept going.
It was a misunderstanding memorialized. And for years, Boaz tried to contact the man behind this brief moment of humanity. He called the photo agency, the NYPD, but to no avail.
Why is it still so important for you, even 10 years later, to find the man in that photograph?
Because after we left the building, he was the first person that I encountered. You know, I felt some confidence in him, and this act of giving my son, you know, his mask and letting me water was very, very touching event in this, you know, horrifying day.
So this summer, we put the photo online, and a New York City police sergeant finally identified the officer.
We were able to locate that policeman who was captured in that very moving photograph and thought we'd reintroduce him to you 10 years later. Officer Marvin Vasquez.
Waiting 10 years to meet you.
Can't believe I see it.
How are you?
I'm good. Yourself?
Good.
Oh, unbelievable.
Hey,
Itama.
How are you?
Wow, you're so big.
Yeah.
Big man.
Marvin Vasquez is now retired and living in Florida, but didn't want to miss the chance to reunite with the father and son he had met for one fleeting moment.
When you look at the picture of us, I wish that people would see every single police officer, every single firefighter, every single EMT and EMS, because that's what we all did. We saw danger, we came. We saw people hurt, we helped.
Itamar, now 12, has no memory of that September 11th, but there are reminders everywhere.
So you're crying now?
For 10 years, they were connected without even knowing each other's names. Now, on these same city streets, at a very different time, they have a new photograph. The one showing a simple act of kindness punctuating a terrifying day has been replaced by a portrait of survival, gratitude, and in this case, closure.
When we come back, Bob Woodruff with those who fought overseas to avenge the fall of the Twin Towers. They're back at Ground Zero, rebuilding it by hand. This special edition of 2020 continues with Bob Woodruff.
It's been 10 years since the most majestic towers in New York were brought down. Now, in one of 9/11's great ironies, some of the veterans sent to avenge those attacks are back here at Ground Zero, rebuilding the site by hand.
Hey, where are we going?
We all woke up that morning, all went through something that we never expected that was gonna happen. You know what? And then all our lives changed, every one of us.
Sergeant Billy Plotner had watched the towers fall from the window of his parents' house 10 years ago. Exactly 1 year later, on the next 9/11, his daughter Alexis was born. Exactly 2 years after that, on 9/11/2004, Billy picked that date to join the military.
You know, in a way, I wanted to, like, my daughter to grow up and be like, my daddy was a hero.
He served two tours in Iraq and was wounded so badly he was almost killed by a fireball.
Your little girl, I assume she doesn't know a lot about the details of what happened out
there.
No,
not so much. She would just always say to me when I would call home, you know, stay away from the bad guys. You know, I know you're out there protecting other little kids like me.
Gentlemen, what's going on? Duty's back. That's right.
Corporal Mark Dudenhofer and Specialist Richie Muhammad worked side by side in Iraq. Today, they are together again, inseparable, working high above Ground Zero.
Be careful, guys. Watch out.
What's your feeling when you're here in a place like this in New York after what happened in 9/11? What's it like to come back here amongst these buildings and rebuild it?
I'm living a dream. Wouldn't give it up for the world. You know, just the honor, just to build it, just to be part of it.
These are condenser waters. This is a hot water.
Sergeant Jeff Newsom is a former Marine, now working on the steam pipes.
Did you lose any friends?
I did. I had a couple that were KIA.
In 2004, he was hit by a grenade in Fallujah, Iraq. The metal pierced his face and hip.
So you got surgery on that?
No, they left it in.
Really?
Did
anything pop out later on?
Nope.
Really? Just went inside?
They said it's embedded back in my skull.
You'd prefer this more than any other place to do construction?
Any place. You know, it's like building the Washington Monument. You know, it's something that's huge and is will be known forever. Perimeter risers right here.
To be a part of history and for the opportunity to work, every week for the past 2 years he has driven here, 8 hours from Maine, leaving his wife and children because they can't sell their house.
My kids in starting school now are gonna see pictures of that and be like, my father built that. My father, you know, brought those towers up.
Now what he's doing right here.
These men are all part of a very exclusive club, brought to the Trade Center site by a nonprofit program called Helmets to Hard Hats, which links former veterans with construction jobs.
Standing on this hollow ground, seeing the flag flying over here and the Statue of Liberty over there, I mean, it's about as patriotic as you can get. You know, I always get chills.
Celebrating that sense of patriotism, just this week, construction worker Billy Plotner got the chance to stand behind the stage and hand the guitar to his favorite country music star, Toby Keith. Keith has traveled to Iraq and Afghanistan 9 times since 9/11 to entertain the troops.
When you see them on TV, they're just a helmet, a flak vest, and a machine gun. And when you get over there and get all that peeled back and sit down in the chow hall with them, they're moms and dads, and they're paying bills, and they're working.
See you, buddy.
Thanks, sir. Appreciate it.
Getting to work on that tower may be their way of finding some healing and some closure and returning and adapting and putting it past it.
All right, man, give them hell!
First, there was like just a huge scar. It's like someone came and just cut New York, you know, like gave us like a, stabbed us. And this is like the wound that's somewhat healing now.
Talking to some of the other veterans that I have met, you know, working here, there is a sense of pride, you know, like you could sit there and say, oh, we did this over there, we did this. We're home now. You know, in a way, the military stuff is behind us. You know, it's not the life we're living anymore. You know, I could sit there and say, 10 years from now, when it's beautiful and everything's done, I worked there.
When we come back, Elizabeth Vargas with the husbands and wives who got a second chance at love. This 2020 special edition continues after this from our ABC stations.
Tonight at 11 on 6 News, we're looking at all the local efforts to remember the 9/11 attacks. Plus, Ken's...
This special edition of 2020 continues with Elizabeth Vargas.
Michael, today is September 11th.
September 11th began as a special morning in Doug and Jennifer Gardner's Manhattan apartment.
What is today?
My first day of school.
What do you think of your son?
My son is awesome.
And your daughter?
She's beautiful. She's running.
Doug Gardner was headed that morning for his office at the World Trade Center. He was supposed to be traveling, but changed his plans, allowing him to be home for the first day of preschool.
He kissed me goodbye while I was at the oven and tussled my hair as he always did. And he goes, I'll see you, bunny. I said, bye, honey. I love you. And that was it.
On the other side of the country that morning in Marin County, California, Jack Grant Colas woke to happy anticipation. His wife, Lauren, was flying home from New Jersey, where she had delivered good news to her family. She was 3 months pregnant.
How excited was she about becoming a mother?
Oh, very. Everything was just perfect. Then I turned on the television.
He watched the history-changing events unfold, but thought his wife was safe, booked on a later flight, sure to be grounded. Then he checked the answering machine.
The first message was just a calm, hey, I'm at the airport, I'm catching an earlier flight.
Hey, I just want to let you know I'm on 8 o'clock instead of the 9:20.
Lauren had gotten to Newark Airport unexpectedly early, in time to change her flight to United 93.
The next message was from the airplane.
What did she say?
Just a little problem on the airplane.
We're having a little problem on the plane. I just love you more than anything. Just know that. I'm okay for now. I just love you. Please tell my family I love them too. Bye, honey.
I can't imagine what you went through when you heard that message.
Well, I fell to the ground because at that time there was also an image on the television of the crash site in Pennsylvania. And it said it was United flight out of Newark. And felt like somebody had ripped open my chest, taken my heart out, ripped it in half, and shoved it back in.
Turned on the TV and my life ended.
You have said that you knew the moment your husband died.
Mm-hmm.
Because you felt him leave your body.
I did. I've never talked about this publicly ever, so bear with me. I was on the phone with Doug's friends, and I just screamed into the phone, he's gone, he's dead, and hung up. And I knew it, because I just felt something barrel out of my chest, and I didn't feel him anymore.
Jack says he had a similar experience the moment his wife died that morning.
I saw something that appeared to be the embossment of an angel floating up.
Before you knew anything?
Before I knew anything, before the TV even came on, I just was going up, and I said, wow, that looked like an angel. Who do I know who just died?
Once he knew the love of his life was gone, he thought he'd never recover.
I did go into depression. I lost 35 pounds. Couldn't eat. You just can't imagine life ever being good again.
Did you think you were going to spend the rest of your life alone?
I didn't know.
The idea that there'd be a romantic life again really wasn't even in the realm of my thoughts. Doug loved me enough for a lifetime. And without him on this earth, there's no way I should be happy, could be happy. I didn't want to.
10 months later, a girlfriend and her husband escorted Jennifer on what she calls a take the widow to dinner night.
And I'm walking through the bar area, and suddenly this very tall man steps on my foot by accident. He apologized, he introduced himself, and we started talking.
When we first met, I was attracted to her. I thought, wow, she's attractive. And then we started into this conversation about our lives. And
she learned that he was Derek Trolson, who had just moved to New York from Seattle. He learned she was a 9/11 widow.
She started telling me her story, and I didn't know what to think, to be honest with you.
Did you know instinctively to take it slow? Like, did you know?
Absolutely.
Yes.
Absolutely.
They both say that at first, they were only comfortable being friends.
But then once the feeling started, I was petrified what people would think. Oh, it's too early. How could you care about someone else?
But you can't possibly think that you were relegated to spend the rest of your life in mourning.
I sort of felt that way, though. Companionship wasn't a betrayal, but falling in love felt like one.
Jack Grancola's feelings were also surprisingly reawakened 5 years after 9/11 when he met Sarah Hopkins.
I didn't know Jack's situation when we met.
Whatever I can do to help.
Jack held off telling Sarah he was a 9/11 widower. It wasn't until he felt things were getting serious that he mentioned Lauren, the wife he had lost.
Does part of you want to know everything about Lauren, and part of you threatened sometimes by the memory of Lauren?
That's a good question. I think in the beginning I had some feelings of, can I ever live up to this woman? But as we fell in love, it just softened, and I have always said to Jack that I would fully embrace her.
She lost her mother about a year before we met, and so we often joke that Lauren and her mother got together and put us kids together.
As both Jack and Jennifer moved on with their lives, they say there's a certain peace in believing their first loves would approve.
Doug gave us enough love that we've all been able to somehow move on and carry him with us as we go.
As if to ensure that, she wrote a just-published 9/11 memoir, Where You Left Me. Jennifer says part of the reason she wrote the book was to give her children a lasting portrait of the father they never had the chance to know. The book also chronicles how their mother met and finally married the man they now call D. D for Derek, D for Dad.
I said to myself, I am fully happy. This isn't bittersweet. This is sweet. We were a family. Every day I'm grateful.
I'm very lucky. I'm a very lucky man. And now I feel like I'm back on the road of life with someone I love.
When we come back, Chris Cuomo with the relics that were left behind from the World Trade Center. This special edition of 2020 continues with Chris Cuomo.
From the outside, just a nondescript hangar at New York's JFK Airport. But inside, something extraordinary. They look like sculptures, pieces of art, maybe something from out of this world. But look closer and you begin to see they are the remnants of the Twin Towers.
You used to glimpse the antenna at the top of the World Trade Center, and it was seen like a height that you'd never be able to reach.
Anyone who grew up in New York or New Jersey, when you'd come into Manhattan, you could measure where you were based on that.
now, 10 years later, it's laying on the floor on its side in a hangar at JFK Airport.
I still can't believe that it happened.
Bill Baroni is Deputy Executive Director of New York's Port Authority. They run Hangar 17, hallowed home of these steel emissaries from the past, waiting to find homes at memorials or museums.
This tells a story in and of itself, because nothing can twist a piece of steel this big, this way, except a huge catastrophe. This is a piece of steel that fundamentally held up, physically held up, the Twin Towers.
Also here in the ghostly hangar, train cars that were stuck under the collapsed towers.
This is a heartbreaker.
This fire truck is so symbolic, but it's also very real. This truck lost people. This truck lost firefighters who didn't come home.
In the aftermath, no one knew what should be done with the debris. Now these beams have become sacred relics. Communities in all 50 states and 8 foreign countries have received a piece for their own memorials.
Stretch it out, drop it down, cover it.
Here, New York policemen pick up their steel with ceremonial reverence.
When we watch this beam put on the truck, it's not treated like a piece of metal. It's draped almost as if it were a casket. It's treated with the respect almost as if it were a body.
Correct.
Why?
Every artifact here, every piece of steel, rubble, brick, mortar, is all sacred to us.
Present arms.
When people see the memorial, what do you want them to remember?
To be as strong as that steel.
This is also a temporary home to these 12 to 15 ton meteor-like spheres. Actually, 4 stories of the towers. Steel, paper, chairs, desks, compacted by heat and fury.
It's a very sobering thought to think that it might be the tomb of an identified victim of 9/11.
Sobering as that thought is, none of these stunning artifacts would be here if a small group of historians didn't jump into action as the world was changing around them, including curator Jan Ramirez.
Such a sacred place, so much confusion. Why was the immediacy significant?
We think of all the opportunities missed to understand how history begins to unfold and affect people.
Ramirez and her team found themselves elbow to elbow with recovery workers, sifting through the debris.
The objects, they're eyewitnesses, and you will find evidence of catastrophe that's imprinted into them.
Get out of here!
And remember the cloud that thundered up streets, covering everything and everyone, blowing out shop windows, covering merchandise with thick, toxic dust. Incredibly, historians saved the storefront, preserving this three-dimensional scene of Lower Manhattan.
When you see clothing coated with a kind of gunmetal gray ash, you know something terribly wrong has happened. Not unlike looking back at Pompeii and you see that kind of frozen residue that has just halted life at a moment.
And as lives were halted 10 years ago, humble objects took on extraordinary meaning. A clock stopped when the South Tower was hit. An employee ID card. A barely recognizable piece of office furniture.
It looks like a sculpture, crushed black metal. In the center are several pieces of colored cardboard. It turns out that it was a file cabinet, and some person may have been opening that file cabinet just before the plane hit.
And a helmet that saved the life of a firefighter. Mickey Cross was on the third floor when the towers came down.
You could hear the pancaking rapid. It was like a machine gun. You know. I took my helmet and I just ducked in the corner. The best way to describe it, I tried to crawl into my fire helmet.
Now, Cross's helmet will go into a museum collection as a permanent reminder of those few firefighters who miraculously survived, along with those who did not, like Kevin Pryor.
They found the helmet, and about a week later delivered it to the parents.
And they donated it to you?
They donated it to us, and Kevin's mom told us that she still could pull some of her son's brown hair out of it. It was that personal.
But nothing is more personal than the site where nearly 3,000 people died. On this spot, the 9/11 Memorial and Museum are under construction, Seven stories below ground, some of the largest and most profound artifacts will be housed when the museum opens next year. Joe Daniels is executive director.
Perhaps the most unique aspect of this museum is that the museum doesn't just house artifacts. The museum is an artifact, right?
Exactly. This is the very place where these towers stood, where the World Trade Center was. It's the place where so many people died, so it's a sensitive area. This is the last column, which was literally the last piece of steel to be removed from the site on May 30th, 2002, signaling the end of the recovery period. And it's adorned with graffiti of remembrance from construction workers, first responders, remembering their brothers and sisters who died that day.
As each dented, charred, and twisted object recovered from Ground Zero ultimately returns home, they'll tell poignant stories. And when all those who lived through 9/11 are gone, those stories will live on.
It is a day and a decade that's almost impossible to sum up in words. We all have our individual stories of where we were when we heard, what we did, how we recovered, and are recovering still. But on this day of remembrance, our hearts especially go out to those who lost loved ones.
And to those heroic first responders, the police, the firemen, the nurses and doctors who rolled up their sleeves and did whatever they could to save lives. We won't ever forget the loss. We will always remember the courage and commitment, lessons to live by. As we say goodnight, we leave you with just some of the kids who never knew their fathers, but are growing up very much in their image.
Jacqueline Kennedy, just after her husband's death, she recorded personal, historic conversations that have remained locked away for nearly half a century. Until now, Jacqueline Kennedy, in her own words, Tuesday at 9, 8 Central on...
This is Don Dare in the city of Loudoun, where a whole community came together today to commemorate 9/11. But it was a different type of ceremony. I'll tell you about it coming up.
Live from the news station, WATE-TV Knoxville, this is 6 News at 11.
Our other top story, it has been 10 years since the attacks on our country forever changed the course of history. All around America, ceremonies are taking place to remember the victims of September 11th. In Knoxville, two organizations have come together every year to do just that, only they do it on two wheels. 6 News reporter Jamie Lynn Drohan has more.
We're all coming together just to ride.
And to ride means to be free. Members of the Blue and Red Knights held their annual September 11th Memorial Ride today with nearly 1,000 bikes and riders at World's Fair Park. Brian Bates retired from the Knoxville Police Department just 6 months ago and says this annual ride helps him come to terms with the events of 9/11.
It was kind of a helpless feeling because, you know, what we didn't know if we were looking at World War III or we didn't really know what we were looking at. And it was just... Everything running through your mind. You know, we had supervisors telling us, you know, make sure you have a full tank of gas, make sure that everybody's equipped and ready, tell everybody they're not going home till we see what's going on. And it's just something my 32 years of law enforcement, I thought I'd never experience.
Chairman Randy Gracie says the local fire and police communities are committed to honoring the memory of those who were lost 10 years ago today.
We all got together and said that there's no way we should forget the firefighters, the police officers, the Port Authority people, and the regular citizens that died that day. There's no way we should forget them, and this is how we pay our tribute to them every year.
And this isn't just a ride for the spirit. It's also a fundraising event, and each year they choose different beneficiaries. Each motorcyclist had to pay $15 to register, along with $5 for additional riders. This year, the proceeds will go to the Cops Run and the Blair Volunteer Fire Department.
From the looks of it, this is the biggest crowd they've had so far, so hopefully $5,000 or $6,000 would be nice, but, you know, we'll just have to wait and see how many bikes actually registered today.
The Remembrance Ride itself is just 50 miles long, but the turnout today at World's Fair Park proves the memories of those lost on 9/11 are immeasurable. In Knoxville, Jamie Lynn Drohan, 6 News.
Also in downtown Knoxville, Crown College and Temple Baptist Church hosting an American Patriot Rally. The free concert took place at the Knoxville Civic Auditorium tonight. The 180-member Crown College Choir performed, as well as children's choirs. Elected officials were also there giving speeches. Organizers say they usually hold the 9/11 event in Market Square, but they wanted to do something special for the 10th anniversary. Three former Knoxville residents killed on 9/11 were honored this morning in downtown Knoxville. A procession led from Market Square to the City County building. The three honored were Tony Carnes, Tim Haviland, and Rob Lenore. Their families say the pain of their losses is still fresh.
Well, it only seems like yesterday. So 10th anniversary, 5th anniversary, really doesn't matter to me. I mean, he's gone. And there's a hole in my heart. I'm sad.
All the families say they feel grateful to have a place here in Knoxville like the September 11th Memorial, a place where their loved ones can be remembered forever with so many others who lost their lives during the 9/11 attacks. Well, UT students today holding a fundraiser to help families affected by 9/11. Public relations students held the event at the Barnes & Noble on Kingston Pike. Today's events including readings by special guests, games, face painting, and appearances by the mascots Smokey and Chili. UT Air Force and ROTC cadets took part in a ceremony to honor those who lost their lives. They say it's important to remember what today symbolizes.
I think it's really important to remember not just the people that were passed away in 9/11, but their families, because that's how their legacy lives on, and those are the people that need us the most.
All the proceeds from today's event benefit Tuesday's Children. That's a charity that helps people impacted by 9/11 and others who've been affected by global terrorism. In the city of Loudoun today, hundreds in the community commemorated 9/11 in a different way. As 6 News reporter Don Dare shows us, they came out for a bridge painting and dedication.
It was a day of civic pride and commitment for over 1,000 people from the city of Loudoun as church groups, veterans, and civic organizations came together to paint the John J. Duncan Jr. Memorial Bridge that spans the Tennessee River into their city.
This all started with one little walk across the bridge, and my fiance Tim Brewster said, "I want to paint the Loudoun Bridge. This looks bad." And the next thing I knew, Judge Russell got on board.
We got the idea, since it was a Veterans Memorial Bridge, that we would involve veterans in painting it. And then 9/11, of course, was in the forefront, so we decided to do it on this day.
Painting the bridge ended mid-afternoon. By that time, hundreds of other people had been at work, some starting as early as 7 a.m., slapping paint on this nearly half-mile long bridge.
It's not my bridge, it's your bridge, but several years ago, I was able to put some money in a bill to get this new bridge.
A military flyover was part of the event as everyone remembered the sacrifices made when America was attacked 10 years ago.
We needed a mission. I needed a mission. And I told Bill, Judge Russell, I said, let's make this bridge. And it came about, and we got to get involved in the veterans, and then 9/11 was coming up. Let's go with the 9/11. That's a good day.
The hope here now is to continue the spirit of cooperation that brought so many people together to paint a bridge. In Loudoun, Don Dare, 6 News.
Hundreds of firefighters from across the state came together in Nashville to remember the firefighters who lost their lives 10 years ago. In honor of them, the second annual Memorial Stair Climb was held at the Tennessee Tower. In full gear, 343 firefighters climbed the equivalent of 110 stories, honoring the 343 firefighters who died on 9/11. We spoke with one firefighter from Knoxville about what this event means to him.
This is very important. I mean, we do this every day, and they didn't know what they were going into that day, so they went up. Why can't we?
Each firefighter going up held a picture of one of those who lost their life. The National Firefighters Foundation is hoping to host 50 stair climbs in all 50 states to honor lost firefighters. We'll have much more on 9/11 and the events held at the sites where the planes crashed later in this. 10 years ago tonight, the nation was deep in shock and grief. Nearly 3,000 people were killed when Al-Qaeda terrorists rammed hijacked jetliners into the World Trade Center and the Pentagon. A fourth jet headed for Washington crashed into a Pennsylvania field after passengers fought back against their captors. In all three places, ceremonies were held for Americans to come together. ABC's TJ Winnick has more from Ground Zero.
Sunday night at the Kennedy Center, the president struggled to find meaning in that day that defied logic for so many.
These past 10 years have shown that America does not give in to fear. Nothing can break the will of a truly united States of America.
Across the country, Americans paused to remember. At Ground Zero in New York, six separate moments of silence in memory of all those lost on September 11th, 10 years ago today.
I wish my dad had been there to teach me how to drive, ask a girl out on a date, and see me graduate from high school.
The children's spouses and friends of those killed got their first look at the 9/11 memorial, the names of the fallen preserved in bronze, and of course, read aloud.
Juan Marrero.
Some made a keepsake to take home. Others simply prayed. They were joined beside the enormous pools in the footprints of where the towers once stood by former President George W. Bush and President Obama. There were events at the two other crash sites, at the Pentagon and in Shanksville, Pennsylvania, where Flight 93 crashed after its passengers heroically struggled with the hijackers.
This is the place where Americans said no. They weren't going to stand for what was happening.
Over 1,200 special requests were honored to have the name of a 9/11 victim placed next to the name of a loved one, friend, or coworker on that memorial. TJ Winnick, ABC News, New York.
Our nation's finest deployed overseas held their own ceremonies today. Soldiers based in Iraq took part in a special remembrance ceremony. Troops were honored with a special combat patch recognizing their service during wartime. Since the attacks on 9/11, over 2 million troops have been deployed overseas. And 9/11 ceremonies weren't just going on in the U.S., but also around the world. In France, hundreds gathered around Twin Tower replicas built to remember lives lost on that day. The towers read, "The French will never forget." Both were about 80 feet tall, and at the event ending with children there releasing dozens of doves. In Russia, the U.S. ambassador was in attendance as churches there held memorial services. The service also commemorated lives lost in terror attacks across the world. Ambassador John Burley said the Russian-U.S. partnership against terrorism is more important than ever. He also said the countries need to ensure there's no place left for terrorists to hide.